Hi students, welcome back to geology. Today we are talking about crustal deformation. And the first topic we're going to talk about with that subject is folds. The next lecture will be faults, and then the final one will be earthquakes. And this kind of breaks it down a little bit for you. So let's jump right into this. So what is crustal deformation? Crustal deformation is when the Earth's crust, so the rocks that make up the crust, are broken, or they are bent, or they are shortened, or we stretch them, or they have been sheared. And so in plate tectonics, stress is constantly being applied to rocks. When stress is applied to rocks, they have to accommodate that stress, and we call that accommodation strain. Okay, so they change some sort of shape during deformation. And as you can see in this image here, these rock layers are not parallel to each other anymore. They're no longer horizontal. They are now folded and bent. And that is to accommodate the stress that they have been exposed to. So what types of stress do we see? We see stress versus strain here. So there's three types of stress, and they create different things in terms of the deformation they exhibit. So with tensional stress, this is pulling rocks apart. Rocks are being pulled apart little by little and eventually start to change shape in the center there. With compressional stress, there's a lot of different things that can happen, but here we are pushing together, okay? And then with shearing, things are just sliding past or being pulled apart horizontally. And so with tensional stress, these are associated with divergent plate boundaries. So if you remember, divergent plate boundaries are pulling apart. So we have stretching and thinning of the crust. And what fault type we see, which we'll talk about in the next lecture, is a normal fault. With compression, rocks are being pushed together. And that is similar to a convergent plate boundary. So remember, compression creates convergent plate boundaries. It also creates a lot of shortening and thickening of crust. So you can see in that image there that the crust is getting thicker and thicker, okay? And we see what we call reverse faults here. Okay, and we'll talk about the faults, like I said, in the next lecture. With shear stress, things are being sheared apart. This is similar to a transform plate boundary. We see tearing here. We see a lot of horizontal offset, and that horizontal offset is viewed as a strike slip fault. Okay, so here are some of the things that are created from those stresses. We might see joints, we might see folds, we might see faults, we might see foliation. So joints are just fractures or cracks in a rock that don't necessarily have any particular offset. Whereas faults are those fractures with a particular offset. So that middle photo there that shows a bunch of colored layers that are being offset by that fault, that is what offset is, no longer in line with whatever the feature is. Okay, then we also see fold, which is the bottom left picture. You can see the layers are no longer horizontal. They have been bent or folded. Okay, and then foliation is a type of metamorphic fabric that we see where minerals are aligning themselves perpendicular to each other from compressive stress. Okay, we'll talk more about that when we talk about metamorphism in a few weeks. All right, so when these rocks are stressed, they are going to react in one way or another, and it really depends on their condition and the strength of the rock. So this deformation that is caused from the stress, like I said, is called strain, and depending on the factor that we are looking at, we're going to see a different response. It's either going to react in an elastic manner, a ductile manner, or a brittle manner. So an elastic manner is when something will change shape, but it's only temporary. So this is like a rubber band. So if you stretch a rubber band and try to move it around, it always goes back to its original shape. And so some rocks will do this, especially if the stress that they are experiencing is temporary and is not a prolonged event. Ductile deformation is when the shape is changed permanently in these rocks. So this is like if you bend a metal bar too far, and then it's going to stay bent in whatever direction you pulled it. And so this is what happens when rocks fold. They experience ductile deformation, and they have changed shape in order to accommodate the stress that they are experiencing. Brittle deformation is when rock integrity fails and we no longer see the continuing of a rock layer and it has broken, basically. So this is an example would be your pencil broke in half, right? So at some point it's going to break. It might bend a little bit to accommodate the shape because it has some elasticity in it with a pencil, but eventually it will snap. And that snapping point at which your elastic deformation or your ductile deformation has been breached and the strain is permanent, that is when the brittle, the breaking occurs, right? And so we have something called the yield point, like I said, and that is when the elastic deformation is passed. And now we are looking at a permanent change in shape of the rocks. Okay, so you can kind of look at this diagram here showing you stress versus strain, and those dotted lines are where you were in elastic deformation, and past the dotted lines, you're past the yield point for that particular material. Like I said, there are different factors that do come into play here. When we have an increase in temperature, things can bend a little bit better. So if it's really, really cold rocks, they're not gonna bend, they're gonna break. If they are really warm rocks, they might actually bend instead of breaking. And then eventually, if the strain rate is intense enough, we're gonna see breaking. Okay. And then with increased rock strength, so the stronger the rock is, the more likely it is to hold its shape and kind of resist that stress until eventually it does break. So what do strained versus unstrained rocks look like? So here's a couple of very simple examples. Here on the left, or sort of the center of the slide here, we have horizontal layers. And those horizontal layers would have been laid out horizontally, and they have not been altered by any kind of crustal deformation. Whereas the ones on the far right there have been tilted. And so that tilting has taken horizontal beds and pushed them up. And so those tilted beds represent deformed strata or rocks that have not been laid out that way and have experienced some sort of outside stress to tilt them, okay? So when we look at horizontal beds, we know that they are undeformed, but if we see tilted, we see those foliation from the metamorphic rocks, we see folding or we see faulting, we know that they are deformed or stressed strata. We also need to talk about geologic maps, because this is where all of this is usually represented. So we've talked about maps in the past, but we also see formations on geologic maps. We also see faults, folds, inclined strata, so the ones that are tilted, and rock types. And so we talked about basics of showing where the rocks are, but also showing what their structure is. So their structure being, have they been deformed? Are they just horizontal strata? Do they have a fault in the area? So all of those things can be depicted on a map like these two here, and it tells geologists where they can find these faults and then tells other geologists where they have found deformed strata, and maybe they can prepare for things like earthquakes. All right, so when we are depicting some of these tilted layers or faulted layers on a geologic map, we need to know something about the rock's attitude. So this shows us how the rocks are dipping into the earth. So we measure this by strike and dip. So dip is the amount or the degree at which the rocks are dipping into the earth from horizontal. Okay, so this could be a 45 degree dip, it could be a 50 degree dip, right? So we are looking at the angle at which it dips into or plunges into the earth. Okay, and then the strike is the direction the horizontal is. So we are looking at something that is completely perpendicular to the dip direction. So you can see in this diagram here, it shows you the dip, which is that orange tannish layer that is dipping into the earth, and the strike is perpendicular to that. Okay, and so we can represent this on a map using a T symbol. And so they would put a little T on the map, and they would write the number there that is the actual dip angle. And that would tell geologists that rocks are dipping this way or they're dipping this way. And then if they show that they are dipping in opposite directions, then maybe there might be a fold there. And so moving on into folds, we use those strike and dip measurements on a geologic map to tell us something about the folds in an area. Okay, so what is a fold? A fold is just a bend or a ripple in the rock. And so those bends or ripples in rocks can be derived from compressional stress. So you see there looks like there was a bunch of layers of rock, and the stress has pushed them together. And you're only going to see folds from compressional stress. Tensional stress is just going to stretch those layers out and make them thinner and thinner. Okay, so we have a couple of different vocabulary here that we are looking at. We have the axial plane, we have the hinge line, we have the limb. And so all of these different things represent components of a fold and help us describe what the fold is doing. So the axial plane is a plane that splits the fold in two, so cutting it in half, okay? The fold axis is the line along which the bending occurs and is where the axial plane intersects the folded strata, okay? So that's the continuous of that axial plane. And then we have the hinge line, which follows the line of the greatest bend. So sometimes it's in the center, sometimes it's off center. We'll talk about what that looks like in a second. And then we have the limbs, which are just the two sides of the fold. Okay. And then all of those layers there that say oldest, youngest, etc., those are the layers within the fold. All right, looking at types of folds, the two basic types that we talk about in geology are anticlines and synclines. We can also talk about monoclines, domes, and basins. And then all of these folds, depending on what has happened to them, they might be symmetrical, they might be asymmetrical, they could be overturned, which means that they have completely changed directions and the limbs are pointing in the same direction instead of down into the earth. You might see recumbent folds, which are horizontal or nearly horizontal to their axial planes. We might see plunging folds, where the fold is not just folded, but it's also plunging into the earth. Okay, so all of these things can happen, and I'll show you some examples of them. All right, so starting off with anticlines, these are our concave down or arch-like A-shaped folds here. So you can see the diagram with the axial plane runs right through the center there. It shows you the two limbs. They're both pointing downward. Okay, so some examples of this in California is the anticline ridge. Anticline, which is in east of Coalinga, so that's a typo, but it is near Coalinga in California. And then we have the Ventura Avenue anticline, which is in the Grapevine of California along I-5. And both of those anticlines are really large views of compression. Okay, so we've had a lot of compression in those regions, both in the coast ranges and in the transverse ranges, which is what I-5 runs through. There's also a diagram there of a plunging anticline, so you can kind of see how it plunges into the earth, and it's not a very steep angle that is plunging into the earth, but it's definitely notable. So you can measure that angle from horizontal and say something about how steeply this anticline is plunging. Anticlines are also really important because they trap oil and gas. So in a anticline trap, what's happening is stuff like oil, gas, sometimes water, ends up trapped below a capped layer. And so that material becomes a reservoir for oil and gas, and then it can be pumped out. So in the LA region and in Bakersfield of California, we see a lot of anticline traps because there was a lot of compression happening down there. And all of that compression created a lot of different areas where we can mine oil and gas. And so it's a big region for that process. Our second type of fold is a syncline. So this is our concave up or U-shaped syncline or fold, excuse me. And so here you can see the axial plane again, and you can see that the limbs are on either side pointing up towards the sky. An example of this would be in Rainbow Basin in Barstow, California. So, there's another typo, my goodness. Barstow, California, and that's what that image is at the top there. It's pretty easy to access if you go to Rainbow Basin. There's a parking lot that basically faces this syncline, so it's a really easy, accessible geological spot that you can go to. All right, and then we get into monoclines. So monoclines are usually hard to see unless you're looking at a cross section, because we don't see beds dipping up or out necessarily like you would see with a syncline or an anticline. But they are step-like folds, so they kind of look like they have offset a little step of material. And so this is where the flat rocks are unwarped or downwarped, upwarped or downwarped, excuse me, and then they continue flat. So they kind of do this whoop, as you can see in that diagram there. So it kind of looks like a stair step. It's a very light fold, but again, this is still compression. An example would be the Chico monocline fault, which that is a cross section of there. You can kind of see the little step in all of those colors. It's a little hard to see because it's very detailed. All right, moving on to domes. Domes are a type of fold that are symmetrical to semi-symmetrical, and they're an upwarping of rock beds. And so rocks have been compressed here again, and we see kind of this little bulge of material happening. So this is kind of the development of an anticline. Eventually, if the compression continues here, we will see an anticline start to form. But right now it's just in a dome feature. So there's a couple of examples there. The opposite of that would be a basin. So this would be the inverse. And so this would be the start of the formation of a syncline. You can kind of see in those layers down there how they look like they're starting to form a little bit of a syncline. But right now we're sitting at just a basin type. All right, so one of the most important things about this is being able to identify these features. So with your lecture, I'm going to leave you with this question to try to identify how many folds and which type of folds you see in each of these diagrams. I won't answer it in the lecture, but you will try to figure it out and then answer the question on the quiz. So do you see, how many folds do you see in A? Do you see anticlines? Do you see synclines? Maybe you see tilted or plunging anticlines or synclines. And see if you can figure that out, because that's really important to be able to actually identify these. And these are just drawings, right? Recognizing these in the field is going to be an even larger beast to do. So with that, up next, you're going to do faults and earthquakes. There'll be a fault and then an earthquake PowerPoint. So it's a lot of PowerPoints, but trying to keep them a little bit shorter for you. Again, here we talked about compression, tension, and shear. We talked about the stress types and how they create strain. And we have folds that result from ductile deformation. So we see anticlines, synclines, monoclines. Sometimes they're plunging, we talked about. We also talked about domes and basins. And then now you're going to focus on earthquakes and faults. All right, I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.